This is a show for the leaders of tomorrow. You're listening to stories of innovators creating groundbreaking technology and change makers that are shaping the way we live our lives. I'm your host, Hussein, and you're joining me while we're peeking into the future. Welcome to the Spark Podcast. Welcome to the Spark Podcast. Our guest today is a professor at the Department of Energy Science and Engineering at IIT Bombay. Besides from teaching, he's an innovator, an entrepreneur, and has authored several books on solar energy, with over 100 research papers published in international journals. He's known for his remarkable work in India's growth towards a sustainable future, and has been leading the change since over two decades. Please welcome Professor Chetan Singh Solanki to the Spark Podcast.
Thank you, and it's my pleasure to be with you.
Professor Solanki, you started your journey two decades ago, and you've been propagating renewable energy at IIT since 2004. How do you define your vision for a sustainable India?
Well, I mean, the whole thing is a dynamic in nature, and what was true 20 years ago is not true today and will not be true tomorrow. So I believe that India has a unique opportunity that, you know, we spend about 35% of our foreign exchange in importing energy. So because of a good amount of sunlight, India has a unique opportunity to actually have a focus on a distributed generation, which will not only will take care of the problem of energy, but will also take care of the employment, jobs, make in India, skill India. A lot of things can happen.
So how did this journey towards green energy start for you?
So basically, I come from a small village, and I always had an idea to do something for the village and for the society in general, and especially after joining IIT Bombay for a master's program. Then after my master's, I was looking for opportunities to, how can I probably, do more research in social science and or join some NGO. But I could not get an opportunity at that time. They thought I am too overqualified. So my guide suggested why don't you actually work in solar energy. That actually, once you do a good technology, it can actually benefit society in a great way.
So it's been a long journey for you, and you've been involved with many projects, including a recent Guinness World Record that you were a part of designing solar lamps as well. So what has been the most challenging endeavor of yours?
Difficult to say, but I would say so after my PhD, it is normally quite easy to stay abroad, and you are comfortable, you are well paid, etc. But I always wanted to come back to India and work in renewable energy. To come back and get the right institution to work with has been a challenge as well as a great fortune that has happened to me.
So you've been an inspiration for millions of aspiring entrepreneurs and engineers. But tell us, what has been your inspiration?
I would consider myself very fortunate that I come from a very small village, yet I have opportunity to go to the most advanced world and talk to the most advanced university as well as be connected with the village life. So I think this opportunity that I could see the entire spectrum of the world, all in its development of technology, people, science, economics, everything, that inspires me to work and use technology to bridge the gap and elevate people who are not so fortunate to come then to bring them to the higher level. So that is that gap, the difference that I see all the time is, I would say, my inspiration.
We're seeing an increasing awareness of renewable energy in India. Where do you feel Indian entrepreneurs can find the biggest opportunities today?
Well, the biggest opportunity today in India is, in my view, is in the off-grid market. Or I would say the small segment, a small power segment, 100 watt, 500 watt, a kilowatt or 2 kilowatt. These are the solutions which I think are viable today economically, but also they are quite spread out across the country. So wherever you are there, there are opportunities for you to set up your business. It may be difficult to scale up such model to a kind of pan-India level. Mm-hmm. But if you are a kind of a small entrepreneur or beginners or mid-size, I think there is a great opportunities in the decentralized generation of energy for India.
Right, sir. So when these entrepreneurs or this market is spread out around the country. How do you feel Indian universities are playing the key role towards green energy future?
So when the market is spread out, the effort has to be spread out, which means that there's a lot of training, handholding that would require, and Indian universities are playing and will have to play a major role. Because of this, you know, development of solar energy solutions and adoption of solar energy solutions is all together, it has to work. You know, it is not that you have the solution and it will just spread out. Because if you look at the government and people watch the what government is doing, the entire focus of the government is large centralized power generation.
Correct.
Which is actually not the best and the most intelligent way of using solar energy. And therefore, this understanding that how and which segment to focus and what skill to focus is not very clear in my understanding in the universities.
Right. What, according to you, is the right way to adapt to solar right now? Since you said the government's focus on large scale projects, but yeah. On the contrary, we should rather focus on the microeconomics of it. What do right. you think? How do you think the university should adapt?
So the first thing university should do is they themselves adopt to solar solutions, So is your campus fully solar powered or partially solar powered? Are you doing all kind of opportunities that is available? And that nothing can be better demonstration and encouragement to a student who is living and studying in a campus which is running itself solar powered. Mm-hmm. Universities not being a very intensive power consumers, it is quite feasible today with the cost reduction that actually you can run your campuses on solar power. Be the best example, use that as an opportunity to train your own student and make that as a base for further scaling.
Mm-hmm. Professor, you speak highly about rural markets in India, and there are a lot of inventors and innovators that are coming up with new ways to solve multitudes of problems. But somewhere down the line, many inventors aren't able to capitalize on their inventions. At what stage do you feel award-winning innovations are failing in the process of commercialization?
See, so there are, as I say again, for any solution to be successful, it is not the invention or the technology alone that becomes parameters to be successful or not successful, right? Mm-hmm. So, and especially when you go to the rural market, there are other challenges, other challenges to reaching to customer, the challenges to provide service in time, and the challenge that service should not be expensive also. So I believe that the technology in such a case plays a role of, let's say, 10 to 20% of in the success. However, there are other parameters of the finance, the services, after-sales services, the connectivity, the reach to that market also plays a very important role. And that's why the invention, probably, even though they are beautiful invention, probably will not reach to that level.
So we're failing at financing the products, we're failing at marketing or reaching to the right consumers, we're failing at also supply chain. So where do we need disruption? In what sector do we need disruption to ensure the adoption of green energy?
The capitalist mode of scaling up probably will not work here, because a very different ball game. So when it comes to scaling up, so there is no way entrepreneur in Tamil Nadu will, provide services to, let's say Jammu and Srinagar. So that service provider in Jammu and Srinagar has to be local in order to be cost effective and quick. And therefore, I think it's a very different ballgame. And I would actually go one step further and say that, look, it should not be mass production, but the production by masses is what is required. And I think when it comes to the fulfilling renewable energy or our energy needs without affecting the environment, I think that statement is right on the target. And therefore, the business model, if you think of a capitalistic way of kind of scaling up, probably is not going to work. And it has to be a localized solution. That in all my projects, I keep talking about it, that how localization makes it quicker and more cost effective, and nobody else can actually compete to that local person when it comes to these two parameters.
But Professor, when it's at such a local stage, aren't we running into the risk of substandard quality installation, substandard quality products, since there's no large scale, at least quality checks on these plants?
Very good question, but that is where the beauty of the solution has to be. I keep saying that it's not that it has to be local, but it has to meet the global standard as well. anybody who can bring the benefit of being global and being local on the table together, I think will be the winner.
Professor Solanki, just one off-topic question since you said that. So will we ever get to the stage where a consumer looks at a car or a solar panel in the same way and says, a solar panel is also helping me in my daily life, so is this car or any other product for the matter of fact?
Great, and thank you for asking this question. A very, very interesting and important question. World has to be 100% renewable or net carbon zero by 2050, you know, just 31, 32 years from now. Now, that is a really huge, huge target. And if renewable solutions are not looked at as you look at the car, I think people will pay the price. So people have to understand sooner or later that, look, I mean, this is another commodity product. The way you buy your car and refrigerator, same thing, you can buy your solar power and generate your own power. Mm-hmm. I think that message has to, you know, really go spread out faster.
So with a solid vision for a future, we're hoping to switch to 100% renewable energy by 2050. So with this growth of renewable energy and being energy independent, to what extent do electric utility companies risk losing their markets? And can we safely say that they might become the biggest roadblocks to energy adoption?
My belief is that they wouldn't like to, you know, switch people on renewable energy because, and particularly the people who are in the cities, for example, because these are the customers who are paying the higher tariffs and they do not want them to switch on. However, I would say that there's a win-win, particularly when you go to the remote area where the utilities also lose money by supplying power to them because they are not able to recover fully. Mm-hmm. So when you go to the remote locations, I would say that let's say bottom 10, 20, 30% of population, the utilities will be happy that those people become off-grid. The government should be happy because the kind of infrastructure that is required to supply the power at the remotest corner is extremely high. The mm-hmm. kind of maintenance that is required is very high. So I think when it comes to the, you know, remote rural market or the small market that I was referring to, I don't think the utilities will bother about it. But when it comes to the urban market and the industries who pay the higher tariff, I think utilities would not like that to happen.
But do you think that could also set a wrong example for rural India?
So the wrong example will become definitely wrong if we give them renewable energy solution, which is not as good in terms of the quality and reliability as the urban supply. Then definitely okay. I would mind it. But if I can make my systems, which is 24/7, reliable, and maybe better than the grid solution in a remote area, because we know that though the grid connections are there, but the variation in the voltage and frequency is still, it happens. And it is not easy to be, you know, solve that problem. Mm-hmm. But on the other end, the solar solution can actually make the power quality better and reliable and can be 24/7. Then nobody should mind it.
Professor Solanki, from the government side especially, we're seeing a lot of focus towards propelling the growth. But mm-hmm. what we're also seeing in some states like Tamil Nadu is the rise of curtailment rate. There's an oversupply of energy by solar, and we're not able to utilize that power generated, resulting in the wastage. So why mm-hmm. is there a disconnect between the efforts of the government mm-hmm. to generate and ensure the usage of it thereof?
The approach by which the government is trying to adopt renewable energy may not be, you know, 100% correct in my view. In the sense that, look, I mean, the beauty of renewable energy technologies are they can be, you know, distributed in nature and they can actually try to fulfill the local load and all. But when you try to centralize and that to the wind energy, which actually greatly fluctuates, you know, the power output of a wind turbine will be cube of a velocity, mm-hmm. which means the fluctuations in the power output is way too high as compared to the solar energy fluctuations. And therefore, you definitely will run into problem what Tamil Nadu is running into.
So we've seen the implementation of the Green Energy Corridor, which would connect states that are rich in renewable energy resources to the ones that are lacking. But the progress on the Green Energy Corridor has been very slow. In fact, there were reports that we're underfunding this project. So mm-hmm. with the existing grid infrastructure, how far can we go before our own grid can't handle production?
Maybe around 15 to 20% of power that the current grid can carry. You can add on to that with the renewable energy, but not more than that. You know, imagine that India has already been growing significantly its power production, and the infrastructure for the, you know, carrying that power probably is not, you know, catching up that fast. So I would say that they're already kind of quite up to their capacity, and maybe another 15-20% capacity is what you can add safely without getting into trouble.
Right. So are we faster than the pace that we should be at, since there is a lot of adoption, but we're not focusing on the usage?
Correct. So, you know, you need a complete solution in mind, you know. So, of course, you need to worry about resource, then you have to worry about technology, then you have to worry about the generation of the power. But at the same time, you should also worry about the transmission of power. You should also worry about the distribution of power. So, everything has to go hand in hand. When I say that maybe we should focus when it comes to renewable energy technologies, maybe we should focus on a decentralized generation, because all these things become very simple problems then, you know. The generation, utilization, the transmission and the utilization actually is quite simple when you go off-grid. And you don't need such a heavy infrastructure to do that. Now, the good thing about the PV as well as the, you know, wind turbine is that you can actually install them very quickly. But you can't do the same thing with the transmission and distribution network. You can't do the same thing very quickly. And that's why there's an imbalance in the, you know, the entire ecosystem to be in place in the right time. And that's why you will see the problems what the Tamil Nadu is facing.
Right. So when we talk about the government policies and what the government is doing, which policy do you think of the government has benefited Indian businesses greatly in terms of decentralized scale?
Well, I don't think there has been really a solid policy or innovative policy that actually helped the decentralized generation. Of course, government has been coming up with schemes to, you know, partially subsidize the capital cost, etc. But in my view, that is not really the innovative. That is not the way it is going to help to promote that decentralized generation.
So what would your advice be to the policymakers of our country?
I mean, look at the example of, let's say, Germany and Japan. I mean, there are 60%, 70% of the solar installation are actually the rooftop base, you know, the distribution. Mm-hmm. My advice would be to broaden your vision a little bit. Of course, there are targets to be achieved. That's great. We should do that. But, you know, reserve some of the energy to focus on the decentralized generation, which will not only will help you to achieve your target, but it will also help you to, you know, achieve many other targets. It will create more jobs than centralized power generation. It will result in more skilling of people. It is result in the empowerment of the men and women in rural area. It will reduce the inequality. All those benefits, I think, are the inherent to the distributed generation and consumption of power.
Right. Professor Solanki, one last question. What is one myth about green energy that you can debunk for us today?
I think one of the questions that normally people ask me, you know, most of the lectures is, so if I ask them, you know, what are the problems with the renewable energy? And the first thing that comes from there, the efficiencies are low, mm-hmm. you know, which is absolutely not correct in the sense that, first of all, I mean, look at the coal. If I look at the entire cycle from the mining till the generation, that the efficiencies are in the range of 8-10%. The photosynthesis process, which is happening in the planet for the millions of years, most of the plant have efficiency less than 1%. The ideal efficiency of solar PV is about 30%, and people are already producing modules at 20-22%. So it's one of the highest efficiency that you can actually think of as compared to the ideal efficiency.
Right, Professor Solanki, could you give us one final advice for the entrepreneurs trying to enter the space in India and be the leaders of tomorrow?
Well, I mean, the opportunities are enormous. You know? I don't think many entrepreneurs actually can realize how big is the opportunity. And I think that itself should be driving them to actually find the market for themselves and be a successful entrepreneur. And as I said, anybody who can connect the global and local benefits together will be the winner.
You heard that from Professor Chetan Singh Solanki, a professor at the Department of Energy Science and Engineering at IIT Bombay. Besides guiding students, he's also an innovator, a researcher, an entrepreneur, an author and philosopher, and he's known for his remarkable work in the solar sector. He holds multiple awards for his contribution, including the Scotch Environment Gold Award for saving 140 million tons of CO2 emissions. Professor, it's been an incredible honor to speak with you. Thank you so much for your time, and we're honored to host you on the Spark Podcast.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you once again for inviting me to have discussion with you. And I hope it will help people to understand the scenario.
Thank you for listening to the Spark Podcast. Join the solar energy revolution and train under experts from the industry. Click on the link in the description to find solar installation, solar design, and business training courses. I'll see you in the next episode of The Spark. Till then, goodbye.